HarperCollins presents Hiding from the Light by Barbara Erskine. Read by Beth Eyre. Lighten our darkness, we beseech thee, O Lord, and by thy great mercy, defend us from all perils and dangers of this night, for the love of thy only Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. The Book of Common Prayer. He who has once seen a ghost is never again as though he had not seen a ghost. Cardinal John Henry Newman, 1870. God is light, and in him is no darkness at all. 1 John 1:5. Note. Matthew Hopkins was, of course, a real man, and Manningtree and Mistley are real places. But this story is fiction. The parish about which I write does not exist. Neither does Mike's church, rectory, or street. Neither does the lane where Emma lives, nor is there a surgery where I have put one. The old churchyard appears on maps and in guidebooks, but is now private land. The real church at Mistley does not appear. Present darkness. Lammas. Lightning was flickering over the low Suffolk hills, and thunder rumbled in the distance, louder this time. Bill Standing glanced up at the sky, where the clouds piled threateningly one on the other, black on purple above the land. He hunched his shoulders and walked on. He had come out here to think, to clear his head and listen to whatever it was that was battering at his brain, trying to make itself heard. The tide was nearly high. The broad estuary, a carpet of white-topped waves, hurling themselves inland off the sea. Above his head, a gull circled, letting out a wild, mournful cry. Then it turned and flew away towards the coming darkness. Bill watched it go through narrowed eyes, feeling the wind on his face. The thunder was louder now, and one by one, the first heavy drops of rain were beginning to fall. It was early afternoon, but it felt like night. Behind him, the town was closing down ahead of the storm. He could feel it waiting, watching, bracing itself for what was to come. His unease was not only caused by the impending storm. There was something else in the air, and it scared him. Scared him more than anything in all his 86 years had scared him before. The old evil, there beneath the surface, was awakening. It would take very little to set it free. A lightning bolt into the river, a clap of thunder on the heath, a flash of fire in the furze bushes on the hill, and the dark would rise again and envelop the shore, the town, the whole peninsula. He had known it would happen one day. His father had told him, and his father's father had known it before him. Why now? He didn't know yet, but there was no one left to stop it. He pulled the collar of his coat up round his ears and looked up at the sky, which had grown yet darker. He knew what to do, of course, more or less, but he was an old man and alone. Were there others out there who could help him? He frowned unhappily, his weather-beaten face wrinkling into deep folds and canyons. If there were, he hadn't seen them yet. What he had seen were signs of trouble, like the blue flames licking from tussock to tussock down on the marsh, fairy sparks, they called them, the sign of danger to come, like the black mist hanging on the horizon far out to sea. Darkness, long laid to rest, was threatening to stir, as it had after the Reformation, when the priests, who knew how to mediate the dark, were overthrown. Hundreds of years before that, the evil had come from across the sea. Native and Roman gods, and the Christian alike, had been vanquished before it, as it sucked black energy from this wild, mysterious borderland between sea and shore. For eons, it had lain sleeping. But now, he could feel it growing restless. He remembered the words, the ceremonies to contain it. But did he have the power? Another clap of thunder echoed over the water and he jumped. It was drifting closer on the wind, circling the town. Lightning flickered behind as well as in front of him now, and it was growing darker still, as though the whole world were hiding from the light. Past Darkness, Autumn 1644. The room was dark, and he could see nothing, but he could hear the creature in the corner snuffling quietly to itself. He lay quite still in the high bed, staring up towards the tester he could not see, wishing he had not drawn the curtains so close around him. He was sweating profusely, his hands gripping the sheet, holding it tightly up against his chin. Where was it? He hardly dared blink his eyes. It had moved. He could hear the scrape of claws against the boards. Don't stir. Don't even breathe. It doesn't realize you're here. If only his heart would stop pounding so loudly against his chest, the animal must be able to hear him, smell the sour fear. Inch by inch, he edged up against the pillows, away from the sound. There was a crack in the bed curtains now, as the sheet caught against the rough tapestry, and he could see a faint line of light from the window shutters. It was nearly dawn. Sweet Jesu, make it go away. Another sound from the corner of the room sent a fresh sheen of sweat across his shoulder blades. There was a grunt and the sharp crunch of teeth on bone. Dear Lord, the creature had caught something. It was eating it, there, in his bedroom, taunting him. He could smell blood, smell the rank breath, the rotting teeth. He could almost see its small, red, evil eyes. How had it got in? He frowned. He could remember closing the door and sliding the bolt. He could remember barring the shutters. Or had he? He glanced towards the telltale strip of pale light. He had felt so ill as he climbed the narrow stairs the night before. The fever, once again, clamping its sweaty hold over his shoulders. He had fallen on the bed, racked with coughing, too tired even to pull off his bucket-top boots. He remembered that. He moved his foot slightly. No, it was bare. He must have kicked off the soft leather boots and removed his breeches and stockings before crawling under the bed covers. Outside, the darkness lifted perceptibly. The stars and the quarter moon, hanging low over the hill behind his house, began to fade. The birds were waking. First one tentative call, then another, rang out in the cold garden. His throat spasmed. He was going to cough again. He mustn't. He mustn't make a sound. He groped blindly for a kerchief, for the sheet, the pillow, anything to smother the noise. If he coughed, the creature would know he was there and turn its attention to him. He could feel the cough building. The tightness in his chest, the agony in his throat. His terror was overwhelming. As the first cough exploded from him, he heard himself scream. He leaned over towards the bedside table and snatched the dagger that lay there, ready, thrusting it wildly in front of him as the bear turned to stare straight between the bed curtains into his eyes. For a moment, they exchanged a long, thoughtful glance. Then slowly, the bear rose to its feet. Downstairs, the maid heard his frantic shouting as she knelt to lay the fire. She glanced up and shook her head. Master Hopkins must be having another of his nightmares. She paused for a moment, listening. Then she turned back to the fire. Upstairs, at the first sound of the coughing, the tabby cat dropped her half-eaten mouse and fled from the room, leaving a small pile of bloody entrails in the corner as she leaped for the window, pushed through the unfastened shutters and vanished into the cold dawn. In the bed, his fear drained away as swiftly as it had come, and in its place, he felt rage. Rage such as he had never felt before. The women who had caused him to feel such fear would pay, and pay dearly for their foul conspiracy, and he knew who they were, for they were on his list, the devil's list. Part 1. Chapter 1. The present day, August. The London air was coppery, metallic on the tongue, heavy with traffic fumes and sunlight. Emma Dickson climbed out of the cab, handed over a note, and glanced at her wristwatch, all part of the same flowing movement. The cabbie made a great show of diving into his money bag for change. Mean cow. Only 3 quid from 20. She could afford to give him the tip. He glanced at her, and in spite of himself, his face softened. A bit of all right. Black dress, gorgeous legs, slim arms, nice hair, good makeup. Business lady, but would tart up nicely. He handed her the change. She took it, hesitated, then handed it back. Okay, you keep it. She grinned at him, as though she were aware of every stage of his thought process. You got me here on time. Just. He watched as she turned across the pavement and climbed the steps towards the door. Devonshire Place. An expensive doctor, probably. He found himself hoping, as he pulled away from the curb, that she wasn't ill. The shiny black door with gold knocker and nameplate opened to her ring and she disappeared inside, grateful for the coolness of the hall after the blazing heat of the street outside. It was Friday. She had taken the afternoon off to visit the dentist. Then she was going home to stand under a cold shower before starting to organise the evening's dinner party. Good afternoon, Miss Dickson. The receptionist opened the door of the waiting room and ushered her in. Mr. Forbes won't keep you long. There was no one else in the large, elegant room. Sofas and easy chairs stood somewhat formally around the walls. Two huge flower arrangements faced each other at opposite ends of the room, and on the large, low central table, several piles of magazines lay neatly squared, waiting to beguile her while she waited. Automatically, she glanced at her watch. It was hard to relax, to slow down. It had been a hectic morning. She had been on the phone since 8 a.m. There had been no time for lunch. For one of the senior fund managers for Spencer Flight Jordan of Throckmorton Street, there very seldom was. To find she had to wait for her appointment was almost more than she could bear. Taking a deep breath, she threw her bag on the largest sofa, and picking up a magazine at random, she flopped down and kicked off her shoes. She had to learn to slow down, to relax. She wasn't even sure anymore that she was still enjoying the frenetic lifestyle in which, up to now, she had revelled. With a long, slow sigh, she stretched out the long legs the taxi driver had so much admired, opened the magazine, and glanced at it casually. She had picked up a copy of Country Life. She flipped, without much interest, through page after page of house advertisements. Mansions and manor houses, even castles, all taken from their best angle, primped, airbrushed, seductively enticing, improbable. But they would all turn out to be someone's dream. Someone who had had the time to stop to consider whether the place they lived was right for them, whether they were happy, whether they should move on. She turned another page, about to throw down the magazine, then she frowned. She sat up sharply, swung her legs to the floor, and sat, staring at the picture in front of her. There were four houses on the page, all in Essex and Suffolk, all smaller than those through which she had been idly leafing. It was the one on the top right-hand corner of the page that held her attention. She frowned, looking at it more closely. It was a house she knew. She read the details with a frown. 15th century listed farmhouse with small commercial herb.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.